This message kind of changed a little bit from when I started putting it together. It kind of went back to speaking of the path that we must follow. And where does that path go? Through the sanctuary. That's right. And there's a man that I really enjoyed reading about who lived in the 15th, 16th centuries. I hope I have those right. His name was Isaac Newton. Has anyone ever read of the life of Isaac Newton? Pastor Allen raised his hand. He's a very interesting man. He actually had 30 some odd copies or books of the Bible, different manuscripts that he read and studied from. He did countless chronologies. And he was also non-Trinitarian.
That's right.
He was a fellow at Trinity College and a second Lusican professor of mathematics at the University of Cambridge. And he's famous for several discoveries. He wrote a book on optics, and he also invented calculus. He also devised mathematical principles of gravity. Today we still don't know really what how it works exactly, but we can predict it. We can demonstrate it. But he also came up with the principles or the laws of motion. I was listening to a physicist. He wasn't mainstream. He wasn't a professor or anything, but he was talking about his research of Isaac Newton. There's a lot of materials that they still haven't translated. He wrote hundreds of pages, thousands maybe. He was very brilliant. He started when he was very young, up to his being middle-aged. And he was speaking about some of the things that Newton was looking at. And Newton was very interested in Solomon's temple and its structure and its function. And he mentioned that Isaac Newton, some of the laws of physics that he obtained through that study. I'll read these three laws to you. It's number one, every object in a state of uniform motion tends to remain in that state of motion unless an external force is applied to it. Number two, the relationship between an object's mass and its acceleration and the applied force, which is F is equal to ma, acceleration and force are vectors, that they're inevitably linked. In other words, if you push, say, on an elephant, you're applying force to a mass, and there's friction, and those are related mathematically. Number three, for every action, there's an equal and opposite reaction. And that one I wanted to start with this morning. Isaac Newton was a creationist, and he did a lot of his study to prove the deity, not to disprove him. He wrote, when I wrote my treatise, about a system, or the systems, in other words, the bodies that were governing the heavens and the earth, he said, I had an eye upon such principles as might, with considering men for the belief of a deity, and nothing can rejoice me more than to find it useful for that purpose. In other words, to glorify the God of heaven. Amen. He said that, and I don't have the quote here, but he mentioned that only a system of such perfection and harmony could be created by a superior being of vast intelligence and power. Of course, as I mentioned before, he was non-Trinitarian. He was Arian or semi-Arian. He viewed worshiping Christ as equal to the Father in such a manner that the Trinitarians do as being idolatry, and with him it was a fundamental sin. And of course, at that time, he had to keep that to himself. He had many friends that were put to death because they spoke openly of it. But I want to look at in the light of these principles that he gave, the path through the sanctuary. And I would like to start with the third one, which again says, for every action, there is an equal and opposite reaction. In Revelation chapter 12, and starting in verse 7, we read, and there was war in heaven. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon, and the dragon fought and his angels, and prevailed not, neither was their place found any more in heaven. And the great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and Satan, which deceived the whole world. He was cast out into this earth, and his angels were cast out with him. And I heard a voice saying in heaven, now is come salvation and strength, and the kingdom of our God and the power of his Christ. For the accuser of our brethren is cast down, which accused them before our God day and night. And they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony, and they loved not their lives unto the death. Therefore rejoice, ye heavens, and ye that dwell in them. Woe to the inhabitants of the earth and of the sea, for the devil has come down unto you, having great wrath, because he knoweth that he has but a short time. Mm-hmm. Satan rebelled, and he took others with him, but there was already a plan that was prepared in the Council of Peace. There was an action, and they were, the Father and the Son were ready to react with sufficient force to counter what was happening. And that involves the type of the sanctuary. We can see the plan of salvation to save mankind. Romans chapter, it's Genesis chapter 3 and verse 15. We see the first promise of a Savior. Genesis 3:15, it says, I will put enmity between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed. It shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel. Man had sinned, and God had told them what the consequences would be. In fact, he warned them beforehand. Mm-hmm. And this was the plan going into effect. He gave them a promise. This is a promise. It's a prophecy. That's also a promise. Romans chapter 6 and verse 23. Romans 6 and verse 23, it says, for the wages of sin is what?
Death.
But the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. 1 John chapter 3 and verse 4. Another very important verse, 1 John 3:4, says, whosoever committeth sin transgresseth also the law, for sin is a transgression of the law. In Luke chapter 19, verse 10, Christ makes a declaration here. This is in the story of Zacchaeus, who is a publican or tax collector. He says, but the Son of Man has come to seek and to save that which was lost. And truly, mankind without him would be doomed. If Christ had sent himself, if he had given into the wiles of the devil, where would we be today?
It wouldn't.
Certainly, we may not be here today, but someone would, and there'd be a lot of pain and anguish, suffering that need not be. And our Savior lived a sanctified life for us, that we could also live a sanctified life through his victory. Amen. He lived a life with no sin, but yet he was tempted in every point. Going to the next principle, an object in state of uniform motion tends to stay in motion or rest unless an external force is applied to it. And there's a story I always think of when I think of this principle and some verses in Proverbs 14:12. This should be an easy one for you to have memorized. Proverbs 14:12 says, "There's a way which seemeth right unto a man, but the end thereof are the ways of death." Have you ever heard of the Lady Be Good? The Lady Be Good was a USAAF B-24D Liberator. It was a bomber during World War II. It mysteriously disappeared without trace on its first combat mission during World War II. The plane from the 376 bomb group had been on a bombing raid to Naples on April 4th, 1943, when it was lost. Although the aircraft was thought to have crashed in the Mediterranean Sea with the loss of its 9-man crew, it was eventually found 710 kilometers or 440 miles inland of the Libyan desert. They were very off course. And it was discovered in 1958. The remains of all but one of its crew had been discovered. It was accidentally discovered by an oil exploration team from BP in 1958. Investigations conclude the crew failed to realize that they had overflown their airbase in a sandstorm, possibly assuming from the moonlight reflecting over the wavy and sandy dunes that they were still flying over sea. After continuing to fly south into the desert for many hours, well beyond their ETA, they bailed out when the plane's fuel ran out. You'd think that they would have known something was wrong. The survivors then died in the desert trying to walk to safety. They walked 27 miles away, further away than where they should have been, after bailing, or where they could have gone for safety, but they kept going the wrong direction. After bailing, the plane died walking in that wrong direction. It was discovered that their instruments were working perfectly fine. The base had only one radio signal. It should have had two to give them a more approximate direction. Otherwise, it would just keep beeping as they get closer and then further. But they should have known that they had gone by their base by paying attention to that. They didn't trust their instruments, and they had a tailwind, which made them fly faster. They didn't have faith in their instruments, and they lost their lives because they trusted in themselves. They died because they did what they thought was right, but it's not good enough. We have to continue on the path that's set before us. We know that now is the time for us to be renewed, to cleanse our hearts through the power that God has given us in 2 Timothy chapter 1. Verse 7, it says, 2 Timothy 1, 7, it says, "For God hath not given us the spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. To be not thou therefore ashamed of the testimony of our Lord, nor of me his prisoner, but be thou partaker of the afflictions of the gospel according to the power of God, who hath saved us and called us with a holy calling, not according to our works, but according to his own purpose and grace, which was given us in Christ Jesus before the world began, but is now made manifest by the appearing of our Savior, Jesus Christ, who hath abolished death and has brought life and immortality to light through the gospel, which is the good news." In Matthew 24:13, he said, "But he that shall endure to the end, the same shall be saved." Are we following Christ by faith into the most holy? Or do we remain outside? Are we backsliding? Are we giving up? And there's a lot of things I'm sure each of us go through that will discourage us, that but we have the promise of a new and brighter day, of it becoming, although it will be dark, it will be darkest before the dawn. Hebrews chapter 3 and verse 6. Hebrews chapter 3 and verse 6 says, "But Christ, as a son over his own house, whose house are we, if we hold fast the confidence and the rejoicing of the hope firm unto the end. Wherefore, as the Holy Ghost saith, today if you will hear his voice, harden not your hearts as in the provocation, in the day of temptation in the wilderness, when your fathers tempted me, proved me, and saw my works 40 years. Wherefore I was grieved with that generation, and said, they do away err in their heart, and they have not known my ways." Where were they constantly wanting to go when they were in trouble? Back into Egypt, the wrong way, backwards. You can see the parallel.
They were comfortable with it, didn't they?
Yes, it was like the test of Abraham. He was brought of Ur of the Chaldees, and when famine came, he could have gone back to the land of his kindred, but he didn't. Instead, he went to Egypt, but then, fortunately, he failed in another area when it came to his faith, when it came to the identity of his wife. But God gave him other tests to demonstrate his faith. Continuing in verse 11, it says, "So I swear in my wrath, they shall not enter into my rest." Excuse me. "Take heed, brethren, lest there be in any of you an evil heart of unbelief in departing from the living God. But exhort one another daily, while it is called today, lest any of you be hardened through the deceitfulness of sin." We should be able to encourage one another, to help one another in our struggles.
Amen.
We should confess our faults. Not our sins necessarily, but our faults, so that we know that others are praying for us, and hopefully the others will remember to pray for us. Like Peter, unfortunately they didn't pray for Paul. And an angel didn't come and save him. Continuing in verse 14. It says, For we are made partakers of Christ, if we hold the beginning of our confidence steadfast unto the end. Well, it is said, today, if we will hear his voice, harden not your hearts as in the provocation. It says, partakers of Christ, if we hold to the beginning of our confidence steadfast unto the end. He finished his mission here on earth, and he's continuing it in the heavens. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 38. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 38 says, now the just shall live by faith, but if any man draw back, my soul shall have no pleasure in him. But remember, you said, he can heal our backsliding. He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from our unrighteousness. Luke chapter 22 and verse 31. Luke chapter 22 and verse 31. It says, and the Lord said, Simon, Simon, behold, Satan hath desired to have you, that he may sift you as wheat. He was saying things that could have caused strife among the disciples, particularly when he was denying what was going to happen to Jesus. He's going to sift them from the group. It says, but I have prayed for thee that thy faith fail not. Jesus prayed for Peter. And guess what? He's prayed for each one of us. It says, I'll continue this verse. It says, and when thou art converted, strengthen thy brethren. But in John chapter 17, verse 20, John chapter 17, verse 20, says, and Jesus was praying for his disciples here. He says, neither pray I for these alone, but for them also which believe on me through their word. In Fundamentals of Christian Education, page 433, we read, Christ had finished the work that was given him to do. He had glorified God on the earth. He had manifested the Father's name. He had gathered out those who were to continue his work among men. He said, I am glorified in them, and now I am no more in the world, but these are in the world. And I come to thee. Sorry, I was distracted. I'll go back. Neither pray I these for these alone, but also for which shall believe on me through their word, that they all may be one, I and them, and thou and me, that they may be made perfect in one, that the world may know that thou hast sent me and hast loved them as thou hast loved me. Well, that's very promising right there. But Sister White continues here with some inspired words. It says, thus, in the language of one who has divine authority, Christ gives his elect church into the Father's arms. As a consecrated high priest, he intercedes for his people. As a faithful shepherd, he gathers his flock under the shadow of the Almighty. And the strong and sure refuge, for him there waits the last battle with Satan, and he goes forth to meet it for us. And the prayer of Christ embraces more than those who were then his disciples. It takes in all who should receive him in faith. He says, neither pray I for them also, which shall believe on me through their word. That's each one of us. That they all may be one, as thou, Father, art in me, and I in thee, that they also may be one in us, that the world may believe that thou hast sent me, and the glory which thou gavest me, I have given them, that they may be one, even as we are one. What is that glory? That's right. We all have the opportunity, if we'll just behold Christ, we can follow him by faith into the most holy place. And the glory which thou gavest me, I have given them, that they may be one as we are one. I in them and thou in me, that they may be made perfect in one, that the world may know that thou hast sent me. It says that we may be made perfect in one. We need each other for the perfection to see faults and things in others. In others, they say it makes you wise, but to see yourself, I mean, they say you are enlightened, but only God can show you such things. But how much easier would it be if someone would just take you aside and in love tell you what you're really like, and I would pray to God that if someone did that to me, that I would react accordingly, that I would love rebuke. Because Paul speaks that we should seek to learn from being chastised, that we should, you know, we're learning something about ourselves. It's not something that we need to be harsh back at the other person. Look at that person. They said that about me. What about them? But they're only doing it, hopefully, out of love. Sometimes you can tell when it's not. But that's why you need to pray about it, too. You don't just do it with them, you do it with God.
Well, if we pray with and for one another, as it says, then we'll be open to hear the counsel of one another.
That's right.
Yeah. It's our lack of taking that time to pray and share together publicly.
Yeah.
Causes us to be distracted with one another.
Yeah, we don't study and share enough together. We don't interact. The society, like we were talking about the other day, you know, when you look at the work ethic of people, they make machines so that we can work by ourselves. But I remember when I was a kid, peeling corn husks and pulling the ends off of green beans as a family. You know, how much is there some device that could, if you did that by yourself, how much time and effort would you have to do in paying for that device and keeping it up, cleaning it, and storing it? And that, I thought that was good counsel and remembrance of, you know, on your guys' part, I thank you. Because, you know, sometimes we don't think of simple things like that. But we should look to others, our elders. You know, there's some people, Pastor Allen is very good at knowing how the structure of Greek works, and my brother Thomas also. You know, they spent more time than I have. Why should I convince myself I'm such a scholar just because I have a Strong's Concordance when he can help guide me? We should learn to humble ourselves. And Jesus humbled himself to the point of death. It's such a little thing to do it to our elders and to those who can help us. Wonderful, wonderful words, almost beyond comprehension. Will the teachers in our schools understand this? Will they take the word of God as the lesson book, able to make them wise unto salvation? This book is the voice of God speaking to us. The Bible opens to us the words of life, for it makes us acquainted with Christ, who is our life. In order to have true abiding faith in Christ, we must know him as he is represented in the Word. Faith is trustful. It is not a matter of fits and starts according to the impulse and emotion of the hour, but is a principle that has its foundation in Christ Jesus. And faith must be kept in constant exercise through the diligent, persevering study of the Word. The Word thus becomes a living agency, and we are sanctified through the truth. The Holy Spirit has been given to us as an aid in the study of the Word. Jesus promises the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name. He shall teach you all things and bring all things to your remembrance whatsoever I have said unto you. Those who are under the training of the Holy Spirit will be able to reach the Word intelligently. And when it is made the study book with earnest supplication for the Spirit's guidance and a full surrender of the heart to be sanctified through the truth, it will accomplish all that Christ has promised. The result of such Bible study will be well-balanced minds, for physical, mental, and moral powers will be harmoniously developed. There will be no paralysis in spiritual knowledge. The understanding will be quickened. The sensibilities will be aroused. The conscience will become sensitive. The symphonies and sentiments will be purified. A better moral atmosphere will be created, and a new power to resist temptation will be imparted. And all, both teachers and students, will become active and earnest in the work of God. But there is a disposition on the part of many teachers not to be thorough in religious education. They are satisfied with a half-hearted service themselves, serving the Lord only to escape punishment of sin. Their half-heartedness affects their teaching. The experience that they do not desire for themselves, they are not anxious to see their pupils gain. That which has been given them in blessing has been cast aside as a dangerous element. The offered visits of the Holy Spirit are met with the words of Felix to Paul, "Go thy way for this time. When I have a convenient season, I will call for thee." Other blessings they desire, but that which God is more willing to give than a father to give good gifts to his children. That Holy Spirit which is offered abundantly according to the infinite fullness of God, and which, if received, would bring all other blessings to its train. What words shall I use sufficiently to express what has been with reference to it? The heavenly messenger has been repulsed by the determined will. Thus far shalt thou go with thy students, but no further. We need no enthusiasm in our school, no excitement. We are much better satisfied to work with the students ourselves. It is thus that despite has been done to God's gracious messenger, the Holy Spirit. They've spited God's Spirit in our schools, in many homes also, in our own individual lives. Such is a dangerous thing to do. It is by the Spirit we are sealed to salvation. There's a need of heart conversion among the teachers, a genuine change of thoughts and methods of teaching is required to place them where they will have a personal relationship to a living Savior. It is one thing to assert to the Spirit's work in conversion, and another thing to accept that Spirit's agency as a reprover, calling to repentance. It is necessary that both teachers and students not only assent to truth, but have a deep practical knowledge of the operations of the Spirit. Its cautions are given because of the unbelief of those who profess to be Christians. God will come near to the students because they're misled by the educators in whom they have put confidence. But both teachers and students need to be able to recognize the voice of the shepherd. Yeah. Have you ever read the book Studies in Education by Sutherland? You know, Harvard and Yale and Cambridge and these different schools, they used to be Christian schools. They used to pride themselves in Bible study. But where are they today? Secular. They've become secularized. But yet many homes are the same way. It's just an example in another place, a grander example with more people paying more money. They look at it as being prestigious to pay $200,000, $250,000 to go to Harvard. It's last I heard about what it cost. And you can get scholarships and things, but there's nothing there that would be of eternal worth. Today, in the Day of Atonement, we're to be cleansing our hearts, not defiling them in secular worldliness. There are and ever will be persons who do not move wisely, who will, if words of doubt and unbelief are spoken, throw off conviction and choose to follow their own will, and because of their deficiencies in Christ, has been reproached. So they reproach Christ. Poor, finite mortals have judged the rich and precious outpouring of the Spirit and passed sentence upon it, as the Jews pass sentence upon the work of Christ. Are we looking for the latter rain? But do we accept the former rain? That's still present truth. We need to make certain that we have the former rain, that we have a conversion, that we're bringing our sins, our weaknesses, our imperfect characters to our Savior. Let it be understood that in every institution in America that is not commissioned to you to direct the work of the Holy Spirit and tell how it shall present itself, you have been guilty of doing this. May the Lord forgive you, is my prayer. Instead of being repressed and driven back, as it has been, the Holy Spirit should be welcomed and His presence encouraged. When you sanctify yourself through obedience to the Word, the Holy Spirit will give you glimpses of heavenly things. When you seek God with humiliation and earnestness, the words which you have spoken in freezing accents will burn in your hearts. The truth will not then languish upon your tongues. In verse 1 Corinthians. First Corinthians chapter 10. It says in verse 12, therefore let him that thinketh he standeth take heed lest he fall. There hath no temptation taken you but such as is common to man. But God is faithful, who will not suffer you to be tempted above that ye are able, but will with the temptation also make a way to escape, that ye may be able to bear it.
Amen.
Our minds automatically choose the path of least resistance, like water. But it's our duty to keep our minds active. We have to keep vigilant. Thomas Jefferson said, "The price of freedom is eternal vigilance." That's one of my favorite quotes, and I use it every now and then. But you can use it spiritually. He was talking about our nation. But if we want to be free, we have to be vigilant in our own lives. We can accept the counter. If we allow ourselves to flow without resistance, we'll be lost. We'll go in the wrong direction. And God offers that friction, that resistance that Isaac Newton spoke of in his law. He says there has to be a force that can enact upon our movement. God can keep us from going astray, and he can bring us back into the fold if we do go astray. But we have to seek that force, that power in our lives. In the Bible, Jesus spoke of 10 virgins. She took their lamps and went forth to meet the bridegroom. 5 of them were wise and 5 were foolish. This is in Matthew chapter 25. There are 2 classes represented here, those who profess to be followers of Christ, and another class. It says, well, one class in this... lost the reference here. But Sister White says, well, one class study the Savior's life and earnestly seek to correct their defects and conform to the pattern. The other class shun the plain practical truths that expose their errors. In fact, in another place she speaks about how they're very earnest, but yet they don't realize that they're doing this. Even in her best estate, the church was not composed wholly of the true, pure, and sincere. Our Savior taught that those who willingly indulge in sin are not to be received into the church, yet he connected with himself men who were faulty in character and granted them the benefits of his teachings, an example that they might have an opportunity to see and correct their errors. Can you think of one disciple like that? Judas Iscariot. Among the 12 disciples was a traitor. Judas was accepted, not because of his defects of character, but notwithstanding them, he was connected with the disciples that through the instruction and example of Christ he might learn what constitutes Christian character and thus be led to see his errors, to repent, and and by the aid of divine grace to purify his soul in obeying the truth. And that's what we are to do when we see our errors, or when we study the truth, or when we're when someone comes to us and says that they see a fault in us. We should be led to humble ourselves so we can see our errors, to repent, and by the aid of divine grace, purify our soul. And that's what we're to be doing, especially in this time of our high priest. The power of God and the example of Jesus is our strength, whereby we will have capability to change from glory to glory as we walk from faith to faith. In John chapter 3, Jesus spoke with a man named Nicodemus, ruler of the Jews, and he told him that he had to be born again. Says that which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the spirit is spirit. Marvel not that I say unto thee, ye must be born again. The mind bloweth where it listeth, and thou hearest the sound thereof, but canst not tell whence it cometh and whither it goeth. So is everyone that is born of the spirit. But Nicodemus didn't know what he was talking about. He says, art thou a master of Israel? And knows not these things. He, master means teacher, and he was responsible for those who he was supposed to be teaching. Verily, verily, I say unto thee, we speak that we do know, and testify that we have seen, and receive not our witness. If I have told you earthly things, and you believe not, how shall you believe if I tell you of heavenly things? And no man ascendeth up into heaven, but he that came down from heaven, even the Son of Man which is in heaven. And as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Amen. Is this the God that we worship? I hope so. A God that loves us and would help us to walk on the path, to get back on the path if we've gotten off. We certainly won't receive any aid from the God of this world. We'll sink lower and lower into despair and corruption until we'll be lost. But fortunately, we have a light that shines. But he that doeth truth cometh to the light, that his deeds may be made manifest, that they are wrought in God. Look and live. Remember when they were in the wilderness, what were they supposed to do when the brass serpent was put up?
Look.
Oh, Christ has our example here in his word. If we look, we can behold and be changed into his likeness. Luke chapter 9, verse 62 says, no man having put his hand to the plow and looking back is fit for the kingdom of God. It's very hard when I mow the lawn to look backwards and keep a straight line. We can't afford to move away from Christ, from following him by faith into the most holy. James chapter 1, verse 6 says, but let him ask in faith, not wavering. For he that wavereth is like the wave of the sea, driven with the wind and tossed. For let not that man think that he shall receive anything of the Lord. A double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. It's sort of like that line. I don't know if any of you have noticed that those sunflowers that are growing in the lawn in the field over near Granny Ann's house. I cut open a bag and dumped them and started walking back and forth, you know, that was to allow, I thought all the squirrels and the birds would, you know, that would put more in one area and it would be all eaten. But we don't want to have our path like that, our spiritual path. The Bible speaks of the straight and narrow. Second Peter chapter 2 and verse 20. Second Peter chapter 2 and verse 20 says, "For if after they have escaped the pollutions of the world through the knowledge of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, they are again entangled therein and overcome, the latter end is worse than in them and than the beginning. For it had been better for them not to have known the way of righteousness than after they had known it to turn from the holy commandment delivered unto them. But it is shapen unto them according to the true proverb, the dog is returned to his own vomit again, and the sow has washed to her wallowing in the mire." We don't want to go back to our putrid lives or our sins like before, or it's worse than before. Reminds me of this proverb Jesus told of the person who cleaned his house, said that the demon came back and brought seven more with him. You know, how much harder is it going to be? A person may not be lost that next time around, but how much more of a struggle will it be? Second Thessalonians chapter 2 and verse 8. Second Thessalonians chapter 2 and verse 8 says, "And then shall that wicked be revealed, whom the Lord shall consume with the spirit of his mouth and shall destroy with the brightness of his coming, even him whose coming is after the working of Satan, with all power and signs and lying wonders, and with all deceivableness and unrighteousness in them that perish, because they receive not what?
The love of the truth,
that they might be saved." John chapter 14 and verse 6. John chapter 14 verse 6 says, "Jesus said unto him, I am the way and what?
The truth
and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me." And in Hebrews chapter 4, starting in verse 14, it says, "Seeing then that we have a high priest that is passed into the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast our profession. For we have not a high priest which cannot be touched with the feeling of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore come boldly unto the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace in the time of need." Amen. We can come to him and we can follow him by faith if we accept the gifts, that force, that the counterforce to our movement. We have human flesh and we have that inclination to move in that direction, but we have a force that can counter that. And it's my plea to you to accept that in your life.